Hello, friends, and welcome to my class. The title for my class is Seeking Reconciliation, okay? It's for July the 25th, 2021. So welcome. Here's what we're going to do. I'm going to play a song that I've recorded called Living He Loved Me. And then we're going to go into the scripture and prayer, and then we'll dive straight into our Sunday school class. So here goes, listen in.
One day when heaven is filled with His praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is He. Word became flesh and the light shined among us, His glory revealed. Living He loved me, dying He saved me, buried He carried my sins far away, rising He justified freely forever. One day He's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. One day they led Him up Calvary's mountain. One day they nailed Him to die on a tree. Suffering, anguish, despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is He. Hands that heal nation stretched out on a tree, and took the nails for me. Living He loved me, dying He saved me, bearing He carried my sins far away, rising He justified freely forever. One day He's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious. Conceal Him no longer. One day the stone rolled away from the door. Then He arose over death He had conquered. Now He's ascended, my Lord evermore. Death could not hold Him, the grave could not keep Him from rising again. Living He loved me, dying He saved me, buried He carried my sins far away, rising He justified freely forever. One day He is coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day.
Hallelujah! Living He loved me, dying He saved me, buried He carried my sins far away, rising He justified freely forever. One day He's coming, oh glorious day, hallelujah! And that's what our lesson is about. No wonder I'm so excited. Okay. All right, so the title of our class is Seeking Reconciliation. Okay, and let's go to our key verse today. Our key verse today is coming from Romans 5, chapter 5, verses 1, actually. Okay, so here it is. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah! Thank you, Lord. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you and we praise you, for this is the day that you have made, and we shall rejoice and be exceedingly glad, Father. Father, we enter your gates with thanksgiving. We enter your courts with praise, for this is the day that the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. Thank you for your grace and your mercy. Thank you that he who knew no sin became sin for us so that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Hallelujah! Thank you, Lord. Thank you that while I was yet a sinner, Jesus died for me. We praise you, Father. We worship you. We magnify your name. Such amazing grace, Lord. Hallelujah. Amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Thank you for eyesight, Lord. Thank you that now I can see. Now that I'm born again, I'm in the kingdom of God. So we praise you and we worship you, Lord. And Lord, I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable unto you, O Lord. And Father, I pray the anointing of the Holy Spirit would be upon me, Lord, as I teach this Sunday school lesson, Father. And may it be a blessing to many, to each and every person that is listening to this Sunday school lesson. In Jesus' matchless name, we pray. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. Okay. All right. So here's what we're going to do. Let's go to the introduction of our lesson. Here's how that goes. Broken relationships usually involve someone's being hurt or disappointed. Many people live with the pain, guilt, and regret over the actions that cause personal, professional, spiritual, or family relationships to unravel. Countless relationships fail due to a simple misunderstanding, an accident, or unintentional failure, words or actions that occur in the heat of the moment, or because of a calculated plan of retaliation or deceit. Many fathers and mothers live with regret of an estranged or lost son or daughter and wish for a rekindled relationship with their children. Meanwhile, many adults reflect on a troubled childhood, wishing they could reverse the regrettable actions of their youthful years and follow a different path. Amen. Hallelujah. Isn't that the typical scenario even in church? Amen. Although the work of healing broken relationships may not be easy, the truth is that many persons could find reconciliation if just one person was willing to make the first move. People endure years of unnecessary, silent frustration and desperation because they have refused or neglected to be reconciled to those whom they once loved or cared about. How sad is that? How sad? And many misunderstandings could easily be straightened out by just face to face, talking it out with others. But it is so strange that many times, even when you make an attempt to do that, people don't want to do that. Amen. It's so easy to get back in your shell, get back in your environment. Because reconciliation is, let's face it, it's hard, especially in personal relationships. It is hard. And many times in the process of reconciliation, you know, we actually can get closer to that person if we take the trouble to reconcile. Amen? Hallelujah. Writer Max Lucado has said that behind the frantic expressions of the faces of humanity is unresolved regret. Ooh. Eventually, the task of living joyfully will include seeking reconciliation with others. The task becomes easier for those who understand the work of Christ to reconcile us to God the Father. The fact that Christ made his greatest sacrifice on our behalf while we were yet sinners. See Romans 5 and 8. The Bible says, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Isn't that wonderful? That way I can come as just as I am. Amen. Many times we hear in Billy Graham's crusade, they sing that hymn, just as I am, without one plea, that there thy blood was shed for me. Amen. So that's what that is talking about. Amen. So we should move. Romans 5 and 8 should move us to seek reconciliation with those with whom we have experienced betrayal, conflict, or misunderstanding. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Okay. All right. Now, once we have covered that, let's go to the biblical context for our lesson, all right? In the first part of chapter 5, Paul examined the meaning of righteousness by faith. This week's lesson deals with the effects of the righteousness by faith upon the believer. It addresses reconciliation and justification by God through our faith, which we claim and should proclaim in God. The lesson will bring new meaning to the song and thought of amazing grace. Hallelujah. Amen. And that song I sang about a glorious day. Amen. Living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming. Oh, glorious day. Amen. Amen. The lesson will bring new meaning to the song and thought of amazing grace. The lesson is from the opening chapters of the book of Romans, where Paul makes plain the need for salvation from sin for all of humanity, Jews and Gentiles alike. After Paul makes plain the need, he transitions to revealing the remedy for our sin state in chapter 4 as he reintroduces us to Abraham by shining a light on his justification of righteousness by his faith in God. See Romans 4 and 3. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Where Paul makes the need for salvation from sin for all. Okay, Jews and Gentiles. That was the thing. In case there's somebody who's watching here, the Jew in the days of before Jesus and during Jesus' time, there were essentially two kinds of people, okay, according to the Jews, okay? There were the Jews and there were the non-Jews and they were the Gentiles, okay? So that's what a Gentile means. And that's all of us, okay? Okay, so I thought I'd clear that up first. All right. Though the law is established, it is a guide for holy living and does not make one righteous. For it is by faith and not works that we are saved and counted as righteous in the eyesight of God. Just as Abraham walked by faith, we too are called by God to do the same. Amen and amen. All right. So now let's go to the analysis of the biblical text. And let's go to the book of Romans, chapter 5, 1 through 5. And this is talking about trust, okay? So let's do that. Here we go. Romans chapter 5, 1 through 4, okay? Now listen. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. Amen? And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. Amen and amen. This is just awesome, okay? Let's just start with the first scripture, Romans chapter 5, verse 1. And look at some of these terms and define these terms. Look at what it says. Therefore, since we have been justified, aha! Now, what does justified mean? Or what is justification? Okay? Simply put, to justify is to declare righteous. Justification is an act of God whereby he pronounces a sinner to be righteous because of that sinner's faith in Christ. According to one theologian, the root idea in justification is the declaration of God, the righteous judge, that the man who believes in Christ, sinful though he may be, is righteous, is viewed as being righteous because in Christ he has come into a righteous or a right relationship with God. Hallelujah! You see, that's what justification means, okay? We have been declared righteous by God. Hallelujah! The Bible says, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Amen? We had to do certain things before we could come to him. We could come to him just as we were. Hallelujah. Sin and all. You know? And that is what justification means. Okay? And then it says, so since we have been justified, declared righteous. Now, you know, the old school definition of justification was just as if we had not sin, which is okay. But the right definition is we have been declared righteous by God himself. It's a judicial decree pronounced by God. Amen. Justified through faith. We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, what is the biblical definition for faith? Okay. I'm so glad you asked. Okay. So let's look at that. Let's look at that. All right. So, what is the biblical definition of faith? Thankfully, the Bible contains a clear definition of faith in Hebrews 11 and 1. Now, faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Simply put, the biblical definition of faith is trusting in something you cannot explicitly prove. Hallelujah! Amen? That's what it is. Okay, the biblical definition of faith is trusting in something you cannot explicitly prove. Amen. So that is the definition of faith. All right. So now let's go back to our scriptures. So we have been justified through faith. We have peace with God. Aha. So the next thing you want to look at is the definition for the word peace. What does that mean? Oh, I'm glad you asked. Okay, let's look at the definition for peace. Biblical peace is more than just the absence of conflict, okay? Biblical peace is more than just the absence of conflict or state of rest. The Hebrew word for peace, shalom, translated in the Septuagint, New Testament, most often by the Greek word Irene, has a wide semantic range, including the notions of totality or completeness, success, fulfillment, wholeness, harmony, security, and well-being. Amen. Shalom. That's why when Jewish people greet each other, they greet each other with the word shalom. Okay? That means may you have totality of completeness, success, fulfillment, wholeness, harmony, security, well-being, and tranquility. Hallelujah! Amen? So that is the meaning of the word peace in the Bible. All right? Now, let's go on and let's look at these scriptures a little bit more. It says, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand, and we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Now, here are two words that we need to define. What is grace? Hallelujah. And then what is hope? Okay. So let's see if we can define those words. Okay. All right, let's go to what is the biblical definition of grace? Essentially, grace is unmerited favor, okay? The gospel message is the good news of God's grace. What does the word gospel mean? Good news. And what is the good news about? It's about the grace of God. So it is important to know what grace is and to constantly seek to get a better view of what grace does in our lives. Hallelujah! Hallelujah. You see that? Ah, okay. The gospel message is the good news of God's grace. So it's important to know what grace is and to constantly seek to get a better view of what grace does in our life. Grace is an essential part of God's character. Grace is closely related to God's benevolence, love, and mercy. Grace can be variously defined as God's favor towards the unworthy, or God's benevolence on the undeserving. Hallelujah. Did you see that? Grace is God's favor towards the unworthy, or God's benevolence on the undeserving. Amen? I don't deserve it. I can't earn it. Hallelujah. Amen? So grace is something you can't earn. Grace is something you can't deserve, because it completely comes from God. It's His benevolence, love, and mercy towards us. That's what grace is. In His grace, God is willing to forgive us and bless us abundantly, in spite of the fact that we don't deserve to be treated so well or dealt with so generously. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! If we ever realized the true meaning of the word grace, we would be changed individuals. We would be completely transformed individuals. Amen? Amen? So, God, in His grace, God is willing to forgive us and bless us abundantly, spite of the fact that we don't deserve to be treated so well or dealt with so generously. So here's what happened on the cross, okay? When Jesus died, He was crucified on that cross. God laid all our sins on Jesus and judged Jesus for all our sins. Amen? And because of that, we escaped the judgment of God scot-free. Amen? Not only that, God took Jesus's perfect righteousness and credited it to our account, to my account, to your account, if you accept Him. How awesome is that? Amen? While I was yet a sinner, Christ died for me. You mean I don't have to do anything to get saved? No, just believe. Amen? Only thing you need to do is believe. Amen? Hallelujah. Believe what? That Jesus died on the cross for our sins. He rose again on the third day. Amen? For the forgiveness of our sins. Amen? And God took His perfect righteousness, and credited it to our account, to my account. That's what grace is. And that's what justification is. Amen? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All right. The next thing is, what is the biblical definition of hope? Aha! Biblical hope, listen to this, is a confident expectation or assurance based upon a sure foundation for which we wait with joy and full confidence. In other words, there is no doubt about it. Hallelujah. When the world talks about hope, it's like, I hope so. I hope that's going to happen. No. But for a Christian, it's a confident expectation or assurance based upon a sure foundation. What is that foundation? Our faith in God, our faith in Jesus Christ, for which we wait with joy and full confidence. In other words, there's no doubt about it. Hallelujah! Wow. Wow. Okay. That is awesome. I think so. all right. So let's look now at our the text a little bit deeper. We're going to go through Romans chapter 5, 1 through 5. The thought of having been declared righteous by faith has been a recurring theme from Romans 3:21. Paul reconnects to the theme again here by reminding the reader that those who have been justified by faith have peace with God. Amen. And we looked at what is peace, right? It's shalom. It's tranquility. It's wholeness. It's success. That's what a peace is. Shalom in the Hebrew. Okay. Those who have been justified by faith have peace with God through Jesus Christ. Is there ever a day or a time when we need peace? With COVID-19 raging all around the world, and with earthquakes and plagues and pestilences and tsunamis and all kinds of destructions all around us, we need peace. That's why the Bible says, do not be anxious about anything, but by prayers with supplications and with thanksgiving, make your requests known unto God. And the peace of God that surpasses all understanding will guard your hearts and your minds by Christ Jesus. Hallelujah! Do you see that? Ah, okay. This peace allows us access to God in whom we trust by faith. Because of this authenticated access, we are strengthened to rejoice and celebrate not only our hope in God, but also to glory when confronted with worldly pressures, as we understand that this process is actually strengthening our faith and hope in God. Hallelujah! Faith is like a muscle. And the more we exercise faith, the stronger our faith becomes, just as a muscle. Amen? So when we go through trials and tribulations, you know, it helps to strengthen our faith. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! We understand that this pressure is actually strengthening our faith and hope in God. Do not wallow in your sufferings, but shout glory to God. In all your suffering and tribulations, be mindful that they are not without a reward. Consider for a moment that your trials are akin to stepping stones, creating a pathway to the other side. Testing brings the response of endurance. Endurance produces character. The outcome of all of this is hope, a hope that trusts in the Lord and produces no disappointment. This trust acknowledges that even though our hope is centered on God and the future He has planned for us, see Romans 8:24 and 25, it has a far greater implication in the important possession of the presence of God by His love poured into us by the Holy Spirit. Oh God, this is so awesome. This is so awesome. Hallelujah. The abundance of His love in the heart of the justified saint flows outwardly into humanity through outreach and is the one true distinguishing sign of Christians as stated by Jesus Christ Himself. See John 13, 34 through 35. We don't have time to turn there. This love poured out into our hearts with a very present hope that does not disappoint and need not be ashamed has a supreme example as that of God's love for us. Trust Him through the fire, for something far greater is being forged. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. The scripture says in verse 3, not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance, character, and character, hope. Okay? So let's look at what is the definition for perseverance. In the NIV, the term perseverance occurs 13 times, all in the New Testament. Verbal forms appear a total of 8 times. The noun always translates the Greek word hypomone. The verbs translate several Greek verbs, hupomeno, and so on, epimeno, and so on and so forth, okay? The root of hypomone, the word meno, is often used of God's permanence in contrast to the mutability of human beings and the world. Hallelujah! God is immutable. He can't change. Amen? Whatever He says He's going to do, that's exactly precisely what He's going to do. And that is why we can trust Him. Whereas man, you know, trusting in a human being is difficult because people change and they're movable. Amen? All right. They're mutable. Mutability of human beings. Human beings are mutable. They're changeable. Whereas God is immutable. He cannot change. If the Bible says He's faithful, He is faithful. Even at times when we are not faithful. Hallelujah! Wow! In hypomone, there is the idea of energetic resistance, steadfastness under pressure, and endurance in the face of trials. Hallelujah! Wow, did you hear that? There is the idea of energetic resistance, steadfastness. I love that word, steadfastness, under pressure. Steadfast, immovable. Makes us steadfast, immovable in the Lord, under pressure, and endurance in the face of trials. The word hypomone means to stay under. Amen? We don't give up. We don't give in. Because our hope in God is strong. Our faith in God leads to hope. Amen? Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Now, notice what Romans 8:18 through 23 says, especially verse 18. Let's look at verse 18. For I reckon that the sufferings of the present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. Hallelujah! Christ in me, the hope of glory. That's why it says, which shall be revealed in us. Hallelujah. Listen to what it says. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. Amen. Amen. Sometimes I give the example of people who have been through an airplane crash and survived, you know. You remember the famous case of where that airplane crashed in the Hudson River, crash landed in the Hudson River, and everybody was saved. And some of those people who were on the flight, they were interviewed by the reporters, and they said, and so the reporters asked them, how did that feel? And the people reported that it felt like this thing was never going to end. And if you actually see the newspaper report, from the time the pilot decided to crash land the plane, to the time that the plane actually crash landed in the waters, was about a duration of only 2 minutes. 2 minutes! And it felt like forever. And sometimes life feels like that. Amen. That's why the Bible says these momentary trials. And sometimes it seems like, Lord, is this thing going to end? This is not momentary. Yeah, it's a momentary. 1 second after you step into heaven and you look back, and eternity has just begun. And how long is eternity? Is it 100 years? Is it 1,000 years? Is it 1,000,000 years? Is it 1,000,000,000 years? Is it 1,000,000,000,000 years? Is it quadrillion years? No! Eternity is forever! So no matter what you're going through, it's light and momentary. Bro, Percy, I never thought about it that way. But that's true. Isn't that true? I think that's absolutely true. And that's how we are. And I think when we stand on the streets of glory, and then when we look back and we'll say, compared to this, look at this now. I'm walking on streets of transparent gold. Huh? And I enter through gates of pearl and all kinds of other things, you know. And, you know, God is going to wipe any of our tears himself, you know. So it'll be so glorious. It'll be so incredible that it'll blow our minds. Amen. And that's why when Paul had that revelation of heaven, you know, God had to allow Satan to afflict him, because he had actually, I believe, actually had a glimpse of how heaven really was. And just to keep him grounded on level ground, God allowed him to go through that. Amen? But that's just another story. All right. So if we suffer, then the Bible says in 2 Timothy 2:12, if we suffer, we shall also reign with him. If we deny him, he also will deny us. Wow! So our suffering is not wasted. Wait a minute. If we suffer, you know, we shall also reign with him. Wow! Wow! If we can only get a heavenly perspective of how things are. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! God has a purpose even for our suffering. Isn't he awesome? Wow. Wow. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. What do you think? Share a time when you were overwhelmed and could only trust God. How did you feel and handle the situation? I've frequently testified about how 7 years ago I was diagnosed with throat cancer, fourth stage. And it was like the doctor said, if you don't take action within a week, your chances of survival are nil to 6 months, okay? Which means what they were telling me was, you're going to be dead in 6 months, amen? And I just cried out to God, and there was no time. I had some of the elders in our church pray over me, and I cried out to God. And the answer I got back was, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. For when we are weak, that's when we are strong. That was the scripture I hung my hat on. And the other scripture God gave me was, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Hallelujah! This happened so quickly. Hallelujah. 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 But isn't that wonderful? That whatever the enemy means for evil, God turns it around for your good. Amen and amen. Thank you, Lord. All right. Let's go to Romans 5, 6 through 8. So let's do that. Let's go to Romans 5, 6 through 8, okay? Romans 5, 6 through 8. You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. Look at this. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? Hallelujah! Wow. Wow. Look at what it says. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this while we were yet sinners. Christ died for us. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? Hallelujah! You know, the scripture says, have no fear of sudden disaster. Have no fear of sudden disaster, of the ruin that overtakes the wicked. For the Lord will be your confidence and will keep your foot from being snared. Hallelujah! Wow! Praise God! Thank you, Jesus! Ooh! I feel like running. I feel like running out of my house and down the street. All my neighbors are going to think, what happened with Brother Percy? We knew he was a little flaky anyway. Isn't that awesome? Isn't that awesome? Huh? Isn't that awesome? Look at it, what it says. Since we have now been justified by his blood. Okay. Now that we're no longer sinners, we've been justified by his blood. How much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? Hallelujah. Hallelujah, so we don't have to be scared. Don't have to be afraid. Amen. Amen. So, and that kind of brings us pretty much to the close of our lesson. Here's a closing thought. As you consider the amazing grace of God on your life, consider the many people who work outside of a relationship with God. God has saved us to be glorious displays of His love in the world. Because of all God has done for us, we should wake up every day asking, "What more can I do, Lord? Use me, Lord." Jesus, use me, and oh Lord, don't refuse me. Surely there's a work that I can do, and even though it's humble, I want my will to crumble. Though the cost be great, I'll worship you, I'll follow you. Amen, amen. All right. This week, meditate on your faith and salvation. Consider how God has reconciled you back to Him and many times He saved you from sin and shame. Amen. So if God has reconciled us, we should be reconciling others to God. Amen. Hallelujah. So we as Christians are in the business of reconciliation, bringing people back into fellowship with God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And we should be reconciled with each other. All right? Consider three people with whom you have never shared the good news of Jesus Christ. Introduce them to Jesus through your testimony. Pray for a strategic focus and delivery that will guide them to Christ. Amen. That's my prayer. All right. We are at the end of our lesson, and I'm just going to play that song, Glorious Day, and I want y'all to listen in. It's an awesome, awesome song.
One day when heaven is filled with His praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is He. Word became flesh and the light shined among us, His glory revealed. Living, He loved me. Dying, He saved me. Buried, He carried my sins far away. Rising, He justified freely forever. One day He's coming. Oh, glorious day. Oh, glorious day. One day they led Him up Calvary's mountain. One day they nailed Him to die on a tree. Suffering, anguish, despised and rejected. Bearing our sins, my Redeemer is He. Hands that healed nation, stretched out on a tree. And took the nails for me. Living, He loved me. Dying, He saved me. Buried, He carried my sins far away. Rising, He justified freely forever. One day He's coming. Oh, glorious day.
Hallelujah! And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord lift up his countenance towards you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face upon you and give you peace. Shalom! In Jesus' matchless name, amen and amen. Thank you for listening. Hallelujah! Thank you, guys. Thank y'all.